Our next talk comes from Pierre-Emmanuel Falcoz from Strasbourg. The ECMO is proving to have new uses in bridging people through various thoracic pathologies, and Pierre-Emmanuel is going to update us on what can be done.
Dear friends, dear colleagues, I'm very pleased to be here in Edinburgh to share these 20 minutes with you on this very exciting topic of the technological advances in managing thoracic pathology with ECMO. Before beginning my talk, I want to kindly thank Kostas Papagiannopoulos for his kind invitation. So let's go deeper and follow in the clinical reality of ECMO. ECMO is, as you all know, a life-saving therapeutic option. It is well known now that respiratory failure is the third cause of death in Europe. And despite advances, deaths from acute respiratory failure still remains around 40%, a rate of 40%. ECMO is a transitory lung or heart lung support technique, and to summarize, it can be seen as a simplified extracorporeal circuit. For us thoracic surgeon, it is very important to know this tool and to know the use of this tool, to know why, when, and also where use it, and for an optimal management of our patients to know how. ECMO means, as you all know, extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. It is a very simple concept. The blood has to be saturated in oxygen, and the oxygen, it comes from the blood flow in the pump. On the other side, the blood has also to be decarboxylated, and the decarboxylation is done by the gas flow in the oxygenator. Importantly, concerning ECMO in thoracic pathology, most of the time a partial bypass is sufficient. By partial, I mean 20 to 30% of the blood flow. So the aim of my talk is the following. First, to describe the indications, the types of ECMO, and finally to discuss the different situations for the use of this tool in thoracic surgery. So, first, an overview of the possible indications. ECMO is currently widely and above all used in the framework of lung transplantation. It can be used as a bridge to lung transplantation in the preoperative setting with or without mechanical ventilation. It can be also used as an intraoperative, perioperative support, but also in the postoperative setting in case of a primary graft dysfunction. In the framework of thoracic surgery, ECMO can also be in use in case of ARDS post-surgery and in case of surgery and following a pneumonectomy, I mean tracheo, broncho, or pulmonary procedures following a pneumonectomy. There are different types of ECMO. First, the veno-venous ECMO, the most simple approach. And currently, one type of veno-venous ECMO that is well in use is the single-station jugular approach with the Avalon cannula. We will see it a little bit after. You can also use a veno-arterial approach, and the parallel lung or paracorporeal lung is now in use. You can also have perhaps a more pragmatic approach with an arteriovenous approach. Arteriovenous means that you have no, it's a pumpless approach with no pump, and the heart is here for the heart of your patient is the equivalent of the pump. The well-known device is the Novalung, And there, in the very thin framework of lung transplantation, there has been some case reports concerning the ultra-mini ECMO developed by the Toronto group. We will see that later also. Most recently, there has been some case reports about awake ECMO done on patients without mechanical ventilation. Excuse me. Those different types of ECMO, they lead to they apply for different situations. And this slide tries to summarize the different possibilities in the, you have in front of a of an respiratory deficiency. In case of hypercapnic, isolated hypercapnic failure, you have to use a minimal support, a support called level A. It is a pumpless support, arteriovenous support. You can use the Novalung. In case of hypoxic failure, the arteriovenous support is no more sufficient enough, and you have to use a pump-driven support, a veno-venous support. In all other cases of partly hemodynamic instability, you have to use a veno-arterial support, a pump-driven veno-arterial support. That will solve the problem. This support, A, B, and C, they might be in use as a bridge to lung transplantation, or they are sometimes, in case of ARDS, medical ARDS, for example, sufficient enough to provide a recovery for your patient. Now, the tools. And what are the some matters of controversy? Is it better to use a percutaneous or surgical approach in case of in the framework of thoracic pathology? The first implantation of ECMO has been done under with a surgical approach, and a rigorous hemostasis was needed. Now, currently, the percutaneous implantation is most of the time in use with the Seldinger technique, and also to the use of an echo is I would say mandatory to avoid dilacerating the vessels. You have on the pointer, you have here a neck approach with a single station jugular cannula, and you have here a groin approach with a veno-venous, a veno-arterial, veno-arterial groin approach with a reperfusion for the lower limb. Another question is: should we use a central or peripheral approach? The answer is rather simple. Each time you can, you have to use a peripheral approach, which is easier to implant and also easier to explant. Sometimes, as in this case of primary graft dysfunction, you have to use a central approach, but I would say the consensus is as much as you can use a peripheral, a percutaneous approach. Here, a neck approach for the inflow, and here a groin approach for the outflow. One of the particularities of the ECMO is that it has to be a transportable device. And you have here some pictures concerning a transport in our hospital from the first hospital to our hospital and finally to the OR. Now, a few words and important words concerning the implantation site. You have thanks to technical progresses, you have a large choices. So, first, the groin approach. The groin approach is the most frequently used, either for a venous or an arterial approach. Why? Because of the diameter of the vessel, because it is an easy and rapid access. because in case of lung transplantation, it does not fit the operative field. Usually, the right femoral vein is undertaken for a better output. You have, in case of groin approach, to be very, very careful of the ischemia below an arterial cannula, and a shunt is mandatory. The shunt can be inserted either percutaneously or surgically. But if you expect that your ECMO will last more than a few hours, you will have to insert a reperfusion cannula. Here you have an example of a venous femoral ECMO in case of an ARDS post pneumonectomy. Another interesting approach is the axillary approach. It is all the more interesting as your patient has a peripheral vascular disease. It is said that there are a few risks of ischemia of the upper limb. Importantly, it is not implanted in high emergency because the implantation takes time. You have to interpose a prosthesis most of the time between the axillary artery and your cannula. What makes the originality is that the oxygenated blood comes via the truncus arteriosus and finally it provides a good perfusion of the coronary and cerebral vessels. So it is for some authors very interesting to use this kind of procedure in case of ARDS with hemodynamic instability. Another site, and a very interesting one, is the neck, the jugular approach. Most of the time it is done percutaneously. It has been used widely in the pediatrics setting because of the small diameter of the femoral vessels. For long, the femoral atrial venous ECMO circuit used to have the better output in terms of oxygenation and blood flow. There is a theoretical risk of superior vena cava syndrome that in our experience we did not experience, but that's written. Now, concerning the jugular approach, there is a new interesting device, that is the Avalon cannula. It is a double lumen cannula with holes at the tip of the cannula and at the beginning of the cannula for the outflow, and one big hole that has to be placed in front of the tricuspid valve for the inflow. This system has been proven to have no recirculation or the less percentage of recirculation. You see here an echo with the cannula in the superior vena cava and the extremity, we will see that better, toward the inferior vena cava. The future that is not currently in use in France, I don't know in the UK, but in the US, they have the neck exit Avalon cannula with a part of the cannula tunnelized under the skin. That is supposed to provide better quality of life for patients under this kind of device. Here, some three pictures that summarize the process. When you have done your learning curve after, I would say, 5 or 10 procedures, the implantation takes around 30 minutes. You have first to roughly measure the length of the implantation, then to implant. And that's the final view. And you see that once implanted, you can correctly see the absence of recirculation. I mean red blood in the outflow. In the outflow, because of the light, I'm not sure we see you see that correctly. The idea is blue blood out, red blood in. On here, a simple chest radio with the cannula correctly inserted in the chest. On the tip, we see that the tip of the cannula in the in the inferior vena cava, 1 centimeter in the inferior vena cava. Now, the future. Where do we go next in this very luxurious framework? First, the mini ECMO. This idea it comes from the Columbia University and developed the concept of paracorporeal lung. They use an avalon cannula just for the outflow. They derive the blood from the avalon cannula, inferior and superior vena cava, and then, after the pump and the oxygenator, the oxygenated blood is reinserted in the circulation via the right axillary artery. The idea is to reduce the tubing and reduce the size of the oxygenator, but also of the pump. And it begins to be a transportable device, as it has been done 20 years ago with the transportable heart device. Another possibility is the ultra mini ECMO. It applies only in the framework of lung transplantation. It has been developed by the Toronto University group. It is they call that the novalung oxygenated septostomy. They have used and published this in case of bridge to transplantation in primary pulmonary hypertension. As they use the novalung, it is a pumpless ECMO between the pulmonary artery and the left atrium, and it provides a pressure decompression and a gas exchange. Another possibility now, it is the concept of ECMO without mechanical ventilation, awake ECMO, that will avoid problems of mechanical ventilation, I mean above all infection of the patient. We have this experience in our department. This is a young cystic fibrosis patient that has an hypercapnic failure, and this patient stayed 9 days under ECMO. He was only under ECMO without the need of mechanical ventilation as a bridge to lung transplantation before being successfully transplanted. You have here, I hope it will work. Yes, just a few seconds of a film showing this patient immediately after the implantation is still under non-invasive ventilation and is answering our question. We published this case report. As I told you, the patient stayed 9 days before being transplanted. To finish with, another option in the future will be the miniaturization. It is a mandatory option to go toward, I would say, transportable device. And that's the great work of Dr. Schwichtenberger from the Kentucky University. They use a very small oxygenator, small but efficient oxygenator, and a small pump that are able to provide at best 2.5 liter of blood flow. So the take-home message is rather simple. Thanks to the technological progresses, the percutaneous approach with Seldinger, better than surgical each time as you can, the peripheral approach And the multiple choices approach, I mean neck, axillary, groin. These technological progresses are leading to a strategic evolution in the concept of ECMO, minimal strategy with partial bypass, not total support. This can be done under conventional ECMO or mini ECMO, the paracorporeal lung. One thing important to understand is that we have to be plastic in the management of in the optimal management of our patient, and in function of the clinical context of your patient, you have to use a venous ECMO, but you have also sometimes the opportunity, if needed, to switch toward a veno-arterial ECMO, and if needed, to get back a veno-venous or an arteri-venous ECMO. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Is ECMO still a specialist service, or is it one that should be routine in every sizable intensive care unit?
That's a great and a huge debate currently in France. We have two kinds of intensive care unit, those leading by, I would say, anesthesiologist, and those leading by more medical physicians. We work, I would say, currently in France and hands in hands with the anesthesiologist. And we share the patients. I say we implant. They did. It works well with the medical with pure medical patients. It's more difficult. And they, for example, with the Avalon cannula, they implant themselves and they do the job. So, for instance, there is a huge debate because the patients have. There are some bad experience in France, so it's not clear, for instance. But we try, as surgeon, to be involved in the decision, but also in the implantation time.
I have a question. Do you cooperate with the cardiac surgeons in your unit first? And second, did I understand it the right way that you even go to other hospitals and take patients back with respiratory insufficiency?
For your question, we cooperate with cardiac surgeon in our department, but I have background of cardiac surgery, so I do the job. But most of the time in France, cardiac and where there is cardiac, there are thoracic surgeons, and we try to cooperate hand in hand. And it's better for the patient. Concerning your second question, we developed in France the concept of, I think as it is done in other countries, for example in the UK, we develop a sort of, how can I say, we are on call for respiratory insufficiency in around, I would say, 200 kilometers around our main hospital, and we implant, and we go, see, implant if necessary, and bring the patient back, yes. In each big region, and there are ECMO leading centers. That's the tendency.
Dirk?
Pierre, thank you for this nice overview. Can I ask you about your strategy in a patient where you decided to do double lung transplantation for idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension? Do you put the patient on veno arterial ECMO before you start the operation, so awake, or do you anesthetize the patient, then do a thoracotomy or a clamshell, and then go on central veno-arterial ECMO? What is your strategy?
That's a matter of reflection with Gilbert we have each time, but for instance, the choice is anesthesia, then double thoracotomy, and central ECMO. And then we see at the end of the procedure. Most of the time, we have to switch toward a veno-arterial groin approach. The main reason is to avoid surgery, dissection of the ilum under heparin. Mm-hmm.
And have you ever experienced a patient who, upon induction of anesthesia, who crashed, developed right ventricular failure, and you could not resuscitate anymore?
Not at this point, but we have to hurry up to implant and this time it was not done in ECMO, an extracorporeal circulation. Mm-hmm. Okay. But each time it's stressful, yes.
Any more questions on ECMO? Well, thank you very much.
Bye.